introduce our speaker. Aaron Potenza is here from Garden State Equality. He is the director of
programs.
Just wanted to see if you remembered. wanted to welcome him and also to thank him. I'm going to do the whole spiel now because I have to run out around 10:30 to meet with the baptismal family. So thank you for coming and welcome.
Thank you. So thank you all for being here. This is great. So as Pastor McCready said, my name is Aaron Potenza. I'm the director of programs at Garden State Equality. And what I'm going to do today, because I know we only have about 50 minutes, is kind of give you a little overview of what we do in New Jersey, as well as where we're kind of at the federal level, and then talk a bit about, do a bit of a transgender 101. I do these trans 101 pieces of this presentation a lot, and I always welcome dialogue. So I would love, you know, to field questions and have a conversation. I think that's certainly how people learn. They just, you don't want to just be talked at. So please feel free to ask questions. And I will also say, I've done this a lot, and I have never had anyone say anything that offended me. So, there are no bad questions, right? I'm not here to, I think sometimes people feel, especially talking around these issues, if they're not super familiar with them, that they may be judged, and I don't want you to feel that way. So to start, Garden State Equality is New Jersey's largest LGBT, so that's lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender, civil rights organization. We were founded primarily around the issue of marriage equality 13 years ago. And we became part of something called the Equality Federation, which is a national governing body for the statewide organizations. And so there's Garden State Equality, there's Equality Pennsylvania, 31 states have an Equality Federation, and so we're New Jersey's group. We do a lot of legal sort of policy work, litigation and advocacy, but in this post-marriage equality moment, we also run programs, and I'll talk a little bit about that. I would also, I think, kind of highlight, right, that sort of the LGBT movement, right, made this decision to sort of really focus on marriage equality for a long time. And so even though we were doing other things in the state of New Jersey, for instance, we got the conversion therapy ban in New Jersey, it's really marriage equality that the public has focused on because that's what's been kind of presented in the media, right? And so as that happened and as we won that battle on a federal level, I think a lot of folks are left feeling like, well, what is left to do? And so we'll talk a little bit about that and see if this works. Why is it on it? All right. So one of the things, right, that you'll start to hear said now, right, is that, oh, I can get married in the state I live in, but I could also get fired, right? So I could get married on a Sunday, I can get fired from my job on a Monday. The states in lighter color, those states do not have non-discrimination laws in place that protect people on the basis of sexual orientation, gender identity, and gender expression, which means that if you're gay or lesbian or a transgender person and you live in one of those states, you can be discriminated against in employment, you can be discriminated against in housing, and on the federal level, you were able to be discriminated against in healthcare until very recently. So as you'll probably know, New Jersey's in the green, right? We have strong non-discrimination law in New Jersey, which is excellent, and we're really happy about that. Because on the federal level, what we're seeing, right, is a lot of these Religious Freedom Restoration Acts, as well as First Amendment Defense Act. And these are laws that are basically, here are where those are in some of the states, right? And we're seeing a big wave of anti-LGBT legislation across some of the states, but we're also seeing on the federal level that the Trump administration has said, we will sign the First Amendment Defense Act. This is something that you know, they've kind of equivocated on. They've said different things to different people, and so we're waiting to see. But what that does, right, it sounds good. Religious freedom sounds good. First Amendment sounds good. And we actually do have a Religious Freedom Act that was signed in 93 under then-President Clinton. But these go a bit further, and they basically, the way that LGBT folks see this and some of our allies see this is that these laws kind of allow people to discriminate under the guise of religious freedom. And to me, I feel like it also gives people of faith a bad name because, and that's something maybe we could talk about, but because actually they've done surveys that have said about 53% of people who identify themselves as people of faith, right, whatever that faith may be, actually oppose this, right? But there's a vocal kind of movement towards it. And so, I mean, I guess to get like a little bit deeper into what exactly we're talking about, these bills, the religious freedom bills, basically say you can deny someone service, right, if serving them is antithetical to your sincerely held religious belief. And some of the states go further and really put right in that, you know, because the belief is that marriage is between a man and a woman, because the belief is that, you know, gender identity, it has to be based on the sex you were assigned at birth, right, so kind of negating transgender people's access to public space. But they basically say you can discriminate in these pretty broad contexts. And I think the thing that gets the media attention is this idea about a wedding cake or about flowers for your wedding, right? Because there were a couple of cases that looked specifically at that issue. There was a florist who denied a gay couple flowers for their wedding, and a baker who didn't want to bake a cake. And so if we think of it in that context, it's sometimes easy to think, well, that's not really a big deal. I mean, I would argue that it is, because when you look at the history of discrimination in this country and you look at sort of the history of discrimination against people on the basis of race, certainly people were denied access to a public accommodation, right? Didn't want to serve people in a restaurant. That said, it's not really just this piece about public accommodation, about whether or not a business person has to sell you a cake or has to sell you flowers, because in a lot of these laws, they go further and they say, you know, hospitals, healthcare providers, basically anyone, right, who feels that they don't want to serve this person. And so the fear is that there's going to be situations, and there have been situations in the past, where LGBT people are denied access to healthcare and treatment, right, because it's against someone's religious beliefs. We're going to talk a bit about this, but I kind of want to do like the trans 101 thing and have that conversation first. But so basically, we're in a fairly stable position in New Jersey, especially with regard to laws around sexual orientation. There are a bunch of bills actually just came out. There are some issues in New Jersey around gender identity and expression, and I can talk a bit about that, but I'm wondering if, because I love to do this and have dialogue, so I don't want to just talk at you for an hour. So I'm wondering if maybe we should jump into kind of talking about gender identity and expression and kind of lay that groundwork and then kind of return to what the political issues around that are. Does that sound good? Yes. Yeah. Okay. So I'm not going to be able to do this whole huge thing because we just don't have the time. I'm going to go through a little bit of it, and I'm going to encourage you along the way to please ask questions. So when we talk about gender identity, and we're going to talk about that a little bit more because I think people have had much more of an education, right, around sexual orientation. It's been in the public eye. It's been something folks have been talking about for longer than transgender. And so we'll start here, okay? So I think it's really useful when we're thinking about gender identity to see if we can separate out these ideas of sex and gender, right? So if we think of sex as just referring to our physical, like our physiology, right, our biology, and think about the fact that gender, right, is a lot more than that. It's not just the body that you were born with, right? It's more complicated. It's about culture, it's about beliefs, ideas, it's about assumptions about what it means to be male or female, but we tend to use those terms interchangeably, right? So one of the, if thinking about like someone being transgender, I can skip this one and go to this one, we're all assigned a sex at birth, right? So what I mean by that is that every single person in this room, when they were born, or if you're younger, right, before you were born, because they did an ultrasound, the doctor basically said, it's a boy, it's a girl. That assessment was based on an evaluation of someone's external genitalia, right? And so gender identity is different. So what we're saying is that if your sex assignment doesn't match the way you see yourself, then you're a transgender person, right? And so transgender woman being someone who was assigned male at birth but identifies as female, a transgender man being someone who identified, who was born male, I mean, identified female at birth, right? Assigned female at birth but identifies as male and you would use male pronouns. You'll also often hear this term cisgender. Have folks heard this?
No.
Okay, so cisgender, like when you do this work with younger, like, teenagers, they're like, yeah, I know all of them, right? It's sort of becoming a generational thing. But cisgender basically refers to someone who identifies with the sex they were assigned at birth. So most people are cisgender, right? Most people were assigned one sex, identify with that sex, live as that gender and sex, and therefore are cisgender. Another really common sort of key piece is this term gender identity, which I've thrown out there a few times now without defining it. Basically, this is how you see yourself, right? It's your psychological or social identification as male or female. And I always want people to think about the fact that we all have a gender identity, right? So it's not just transgender people. Like, every single person in this room either thinks of themselves as male, right? That means something to them deeply, right? I'm male, right? Or thinks of themselves as female, or in the case of non-binary people, might think of themselves as something outside of that or beyond that. Yes?
Would you explain the term non-binary?
Yes, I absolutely will. We can skip that. Yes, let's do that. So the binary is this concept, right? Based on sort of societal norms that there are two genders, male and female, right? The idea of a spectrum is this belief that, well, maybe it's not as simple as male and female. Maybe if we're thinking about gender, we're thinking about the social piece. We think about masculinity and femininity. Maybe we don't all fit neatly into one of those boxes, right? So when I get to this point, I usually ask folks, why don't you give me an example of someone from popular culture that you see as like 100% male?
John Wayne.
John Wayne. All right. That is excellent. No. We all know John Wayne is a man. All right. So let's say John Wayne could be here, and we ask John Wayne, and he goes and stands over there, right? So John Wayne's over in that corner. So why don't you give me another person from popular culture you see as 100% female?
Sophia Loren.
Okay. So we have Sophia Loren. And we have John Wayne. So if I then said to you, why doesn't everyone come up here? And you can stand next to John Wayne, or you can stand next to Sophia Loren, or you can stand somewhere on a line in between them, what do you think would happen?
Middle.
Okay. So I think you would see people all over that line, including in the middle. I think that men would feel more pressure to stand next to John Wayne than women might feel to stand next to Sophia Loren, right? Some of that is about behavior, right? It doesn't have to be about clothing. So when I talk about it being about behavior, I always use my sister and her husband as an example. My sister, she's a musician, so she has a particular feminine look, but it's feminine, right? Dresses, skirts, makeup, jewelry. Hair, heels, all that. So she might stand next to Sophia Loren if you said, I'm talking about the way you look. And her husband is like 6'4", he's got a big hipster beard. He would stand over near John Wayne. But behavior is different, right? My sister is actually a much more aggressive and assertive person than I am. She's certainly more so than Ian, her husband. He's kind of shy, right? So that's not necessarily about their identity, but it's about thinking about how this line with John Wayne and Sophia Loren, there are people who fall out all over that, and we recognize that in everyday life, right? That probably not too many people are 100% masculine if we think about those sex stereotypes, basically. And probably not too many people are 100% feminine. That doesn't mean there's anything wrong with John Wayne or Sophia Loren, right? But it's this idea that we kind of fall out somewhere along that line when we think about the social. So what I would say then is that most people understand that, right? Okay, yes, gender isn't just either or in terms of how I practice it. But most people, including most transgender people, still think of gender as either or in terms of your identity. You either identify as male or female. And this is what your question was about, what's this term non-binary? So the idea of non-binary is this idea that some transgender people, certainly not all, but some, don't see themselves as fitting within that in terms of how they see themselves, right? So they might not feel that they're 100% male, not feel that they're 100% female. There are various ways to express that, and certainly you may have encountered this with younger people in your life. This is much more something that young people are starting to identify with, right? Sort of identifying outside that binary. Now, there have always been people who identified not really 100% one way or the other, sometimes presenting as male, sometimes female, but research is definitely showing that younger people are increasingly identifying that way. And I think, yes.
Is there, or has there been an age, or when gender identity is really established?
Yes. So I am not a psychologist, and so that's a caveat, right? But psychologists who work on this issue, and this makes sense to me, they have said that all children, right, all children are pretty aware of the way that they understand themselves as being male or female around 2 or 3 years old, right? So you've probably, some of you have had kids. A one-year-old is pretty pre-verbal, right? They're not really, you don't know how they're identifying, but certainly a 2 or 3 year-old is probably starting to see the world is male or the world is female and here's where I belong, right? And so the argument or the evidence is showing that that's true for transgender people as well. That sense of yourself as male or female comes to you around 2, 3, 4 years old, and that with transgender people, it doesn't match the sex they were assigned at birth, right? We're doing this in a very, I always want to go through all of them in order, but that's okay because we just don't have the time. So I will say, I usually do this with some slides, but I myself am a transgender person, right? So what that means for me is that I was assigned female at birth, but I identify as male. I live as a man, whatever that means. For me, it means in the social world, right? I go out, I go to get a cup of coffee, here's your coffee, sir. Right? Nobody says, here's your coffee, ma'am. For me, I cannot say, I can't go back that far in my memory, maybe because I'm 40 now, right? So do I remember what I was thinking when I was 3 or 4? No. I do remember recognizing that there was a difference between me and other girls, that I felt like I belonged with the boys, that all my friends were, that sort of a thing, for a long period of time, and that I certainly articulated this, but this was in the 80s, right? Mm-hmm. So articulating that in the 80s, your parents were likely to say, well, that's fine that you think that, but that's not reality, that's not what's gonna happen, right? And as society and culture has evolved, we're saying more to kids, okay, we're listening to you about that.
I have a little problem with your age number, though. I have a granddaughter and a grandson. The grandson's 4 years younger than the granddaughter. And, you know, as a two-year-old, he's running around in her little Tinkerbell outfits and, and whatnot and liking girl things. But now approaching six, he's definitely does all the male things, you know, with the cars and the trucks and the things that most boys do.
So, absolutely, most children, right, if they're allowed to, most children will kind of figure it out, play with gender, right? And so certainly younger kids, like your grandson's 2, 3, 4, he might be wanting to wear tutus, he might be wanting a Barbie doll, he might seem very fixated on that. That does not mean that he's transgender, right? So when I was answering that, I was saying transgender people probably know that identity at that age. That does not mean, right, that all kids who express across gender are transgender, right? And so what, I mean, I think part of that question is like, how do you deal with this if it's your kid? How do you deal with this in a family? How do you make sure you don't make mistakes around this? And so basically, and I would say this is from both research, right, but also experience in working with a lot of young people across New Jersey who are transgender. Psychologists will ask for this to be a consistent, right, that the kid is consistent in it, that they're persistent in it, so that it's not just, you know, it happens for a few months, it happens for a year, but that over a period of time, this is a child who is very insistent as well, that, oh no, I am a boy, right? And so the protocol is sort of, look, we should allow all children to express, you know, like they're gonna express male, they're gonna express female, they're gonna play with it. That does not mean that your child is transgender. If the kid is really insistent about it, and if they start talking about like negative stuff, right? So a lot of the parents I've worked with transgender children talk about the kid being suicidal even to that degree, right? But certainly expressing a lot of depression and anxiety around it, very upset about it. If that persists, if you're dealing with a kid who's like really, really very upset about this for a decent period of time, then the protocol would be, well, why don't you take this kid to a therapist who has expertise in this area. That therapist is gonna see that child for a while. They're not gonna see them once or twice and say, you're right, your kid's transgender, right? They're gonna see them for a while. Over time, they may come to say to the parent, you know, the kid's just gender creative. They may continue in this path, they may not. Or they may say to the parent, you know, this kid is pretty textbook transgender. At that point, right? So say, let's say that happens. At that point, I think people start to fear that this is something irreversible as well, to allow the kid to transition, but they're actually just talking about a social transition, right? So there's, I'll get you in a second. So there's like three components of a transition broadly, like groups, right? So one of them is social, and that would be changing the way you present your clothing, right? Changing your name, changing your pronouns, but it doesn't have to be a legal name change, right? So then there's the legal component, which is change your identity documents, change your legal name. And then there's the medical component, right, which can include a wide array, right, surgery, hormone replacement therapy, et cetera. Nobody is advocating medical transition for children that are prepubescent. With children that have persisted for a long time, so say this kid transitioned in second grade. Now they're 11 or 12, they're going into puberty. They have a diagnosis, the parents have been taking them to a therapist for some time. They may decide to take puberty blockers at that point, and I can talk a bit about that. We were not seeing a lot of kids do any piece of a legal transition until recently. Kids aren't changing their birth certificates, and they certainly don't have driver's licenses till a certain age. But we are seeing some children's parents start to do the name change process earlier, start to do the change with Social Security earlier, start to do the change with a passport earlier. And I have to say, a lot of that comes out of fear on the part of those parents for their child, right? So they're feeling like, I gotta get this done because I want my kid to go into school and I don't want the school to know because I don't want there to be bullying. Or I gotta get this done Because right now the State Department says one thing, well, what if next year they say another? That sort of thing. So we are starting to see a little bit more of that. Do you have a question?
Yes, the saying the transgender, but what about gay and lesbian? That's different.
Yes. Okay. That's actually the next slide.
Oh.
That's good. Okay. So oftentimes we hear about sexual identity or sexual orientation, gender identity, gender orientation, right? Sexual orientation. When you're talking about someone being gay or lesbian, that's about who they're attracted to, right? Whether that attraction is sexual or emotional or both, right? This simple way to put it is like, it's who you go to bed with, or who you want to go to bed with, who you fantasize about going to bed with, right? Whereas gender identity is who you go to bed as. So someone being transgender is about thinking of yourself as male or female, whereas sexual orientation is about who am I attracted to, right? And transgender people, therefore, have a sexual orientation, right? So transgender people can be gay, they can be lesbian, they can be straight, they can be bisexual, just like people who are not transgender. Does that sort of...
Thank you.
Yes.
What's queer?
Queer?
Yes.
Okay.
LGBTQ. Right.
Okay. So queer is a term, right, that has a negative pejorative history, right? This was a slur, basically, against LGBT people for many years. And it's a term that younger people have kind of recuperated. So a lot of younger people feel like, and not just younger people, but primarily, right? Like it's more of a generational thing. But some folks who identify within the LGBT community feel like, you know what, that may have a negative history, but I take it to mean that I'm different and I embrace that difference. I think that's a positive thing, and so I identify as queer, as different from the norm around gender identity or sexual orientation. I always, you know, I work across kind of age groups, right? Because I'll do these trainings for workplaces, for hospitals, for schools where they have a lot of young people. So what I'll always kind of want people to know about the term queer, you want to be careful with it. Because a lot of LGBT people, and especially generationally older, and I don't mean to say older because I'm older now. I would give this as an example. In my office, the guy who is our director of operations, lovely man, he's not that much older than I am, he's in his like late 40s, he hates that term, right? Because that was something that people called him. So he finds it, even you can tell when young people are in the office and they're using it, I can almost like feel his response to it. And he's talked about it with me a bit, saying, you know, I understand young people are using this now. I'll never see it as a positive thing. It reminds me of things that happened to me, and I don't like it, right? But young people are very much embracing it. And some folks, and I've known people who are 70 who came up to me after and said, oh, I'm lesbian and I love the term queer. I never liked the term lesbian. I like queer. So it's not just generational, but primarily. So I always say, you know, and I think this is true with identity in general, let the person tell you how they identify, and then it's fine to kind of mirror that language back to them, but don't just feel like if you go out and say queer, that everyone's gonna love that term, because a lot of LGBT people actually don't like that term. Is that? So I'm thinking we should just do more questions. If people have them.
I have a neighbor who is transsexual, is that the correct term? She was a male and is now a female.
Mm-hmm.
But she has now married a woman.
Yes.
And I don't understand
that. Yes. So there's two pieces of that question. I think the first part you said she's transsexual, and is that the correct term? So transsexual is a term that we were using for a long time. People, similar to homosexual, it's kind of falling out of favor. It seems kind of medicalized, right? like it's almost like a medical term. That doesn't mean it's wrong. It's just, I think some people will identify as transsexual. Other folks, especially who are younger, will say, oh no, it's transgender and you've offended me. Now you didn't offend me. But it just, right? In terms of her sexual orientation, okay, so this falls under, if a transgender woman tells you she's married to a woman, she lives with a woman, she's lesbian. Does that make sense to people? Because I have a whole, like, here's what's make that, help you make sense of that. Is that like a yes, no, okay. So I can kind of use myself as an example here. So I'm a transgender man. What that means is I was assigned female at birth, right? I identify as male. So I present as male. People, if I walked in this room, probably thought like he's either transgender or he's male, right? Or he's a transgender man. I'm married to a man. So this is about my sexual orientation, right? So prior to transitioning, I was attracted to and dated men. After transitioning, I'm attracted to and date men. For myself and my husband, we see ourselves as a gay couple. Because, two things. One, the outside world piece of it, the social world, right? So if people see Aaron and James walking their dog, oh, those guys live at that house, oh, here those guys are coming out to dinner again. We actually, I was raised Catholic, so sometimes I'll go to the Mass, so sometimes we'll go there. And they'll probably be like, that's a gay couple, right? People see us that way. Right, and so there's a similarity between the way we experience the social world and the way other gay men experience the social world. In that, you think about that sort of thing, right? You think about, do I want to go to visit this particular place on my vacation because I've heard negative or positive things, right? And they're going to see me. They're not going to see me as transgender. They're going to see me as a gay man because I'm with this other guy, right? So there's that piece of it. I think the reason people have trouble with it is that people want to think that they know what other people are doing in bed. So people hear that you're gay or your neighbor, right? She's lesbian. And they wonder, well, this is a transgender person, so have they had the surgery, right? What's in their pants? And what are they doing? And does it fit with my conception of what it means for two men to be together? And I always tell people this. We, none of us know anything about what anyone's doing in bed, right? What we really know, the one thing I feel like I can confidently say, is that most people are lying about it. So, you know, you don't know what I'm doing. I'm not going to tell you what I'm doing. And so it's more about, I think, both your identification and like how you see yourself and how you're living in the world, right? Does that sort of answer that? And it's also, I think, one other thing, like I said for myself, I dated men before I transitioned, I dated men after I transitioned, I was always attracted to men, I was never really attracted to women. That's my experience. Everyone has a different experience. So I've known plenty of transgender people, for instance, like, I don't know if this is your neighbor's situation, but a couple of trans women, friends of mine, who were married to a woman. They then transitioned, they stayed married to that woman, right? Or they transitioned and other people transition and start to feel like, you know, now that I'm presenting female, now that everyone's seeing me as female, I'm a heterosexual person. Like, so there's almost an identification with that as well, right? That maybe you were a man married to a woman, you're a heterosexual couple, you transition, now you're a woman, and you still feel like, I'm heterosexual, I fit into the world this way. So I think one of the really important things to always emphasize about any of this is that it's individual, just like anything else, right? Just like someone's experience of their racial identity is individual, you can't ask someone, hey, why don't you stand in for this whole group of people and explain that whole group of people to me. I can talk about this because it's been my background work-wise, right? But when I talk about my experience is just my experience. It's a very individualized thing. I think you had a question.
No, it was actually just a comment. children, and how soon, you talked about it before, right? How soon sometimes children.
Yeah.
And my daughter has a nephew who identified very early, you know, 3-4 years old. He was a boy, but he wanted a braid in his hair, and he wanted, you know, female things, I think. And luckily, his parents were very open to it. And his mom clipped a braid into his short hair, so he was happy that way. I just thought that was kind of a neat
observation. For me, I think I've worked with a lot of kids who are either transgender or who are just kind of more of what people are calling gender creative, right? They're not like completely fitting into the male, female, and that's okay. We're dealing with that differently than we used to.
Yeah.
Yes. Shirt, then blue shirt.
I have been teaching art for 15 years now, teaching elementary school from K through 5. And because I work in Berkeley Heights, and because I'm the art teacher, I see kids for just 1 hour a week, right? Mm-hmm. But I see them through an expansive time. And I've seen one example is in kindergarten. I have a lot of kids, but one particularly stands out, a little girl named Sonia, who, cute as a button, but sort of a tomboy, but really, as the year went on, seemed more and more hanging out with the boys. But although she wasn't a roughneck, do you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And her teacher came to me, her classroom teacher, and said, you know, Sonia really is trying herself out. You know, she's trying on different identities. She left for summer and came back in first grade. I had her again, and the first week of school, she pulled me aside. She said, could I talk to you in the hallway? I said, sure. And she says, I want you to call me he. So I was I wasn't quite sure I was hearing her correctly, because here she's 6 years old now, you know, and she said to me, do you know what I mean? And I said, you want me to call you like a boy's pronoun, you know, a he, and or him, or your, his. She said yes, or he said yes. You know what I mean? So I said, okay. I said, you've got it. So in the classroom, you know, I was fine. Then I went to see our teacher at lunch, and I said, you know, Susan, what happened? And she said, well, she wanted me to tell the class that she is a boy, and that the whole class should refer to him as a him.
Right.
And you know what? She had it right. I mean, she had it right on. I said, what are the parents? She said, the mom is trying to deal with it. She's an only girl in a family of other boys, and the mom is having the most difficult time accepting that she really wants to be a he.
Right.
So she's absent one day, and I'm teaching, and I said, what are we going to do with Sonia's work? Should I put her work somewhere? And they said, no, it's a he. Where should she put it? The whole class corrected me. And they got it.
I think. Yeah.
I've had other kids, I mean, all the way through over the years, but when I'm talking about children who are trying to choose their gender, only the ones that stand out as being Sophia Loren or John Wayne are the ones who really, like, I could count on my hand and point to them.
Right.
And the schools, at least the situation where I have been close with those kids, the schools have done have done a tremendous job to accept the child, and not so much as changing the pronouns for all of them, like this little girl demanded it, you know, but the other ones really have done a tremendous job in helping the children be comfortable with where they fit on the spectrum.
So one of the things that really stood out for me there is when you were talking about how accepting the other children were. And we have seen that across the board, and it tends to be one of the fears that parents have. How do I talk to my kids about this? I can't tell my kid this about my other kid, right? Kids are not only resilient, but they haven't had as much time to kind of become entrenched in those attitudes and in that perception of male, female as just, you know, yes. Oh, I said blue sweater. So blue sweater, red sweater.
I worked in a school with kids that had special emotional needs, and we would see quite a bit of the gender identity exploration. And one of the things that I sometimes wondered about, because I was working mostly with teenagers, was that, you know, most of us have been through a variety of phases of the sexual revolution. And I sometimes wonder if the kids that have been growing up in the last, you know, 10, 20 years have had to struggle with the pressures of that, of dealing with their sexuality, dealing with how they're going to work their relationships. And I've sometimes wondered with some of these kids who go back and forth, if part of this exploration of gender identity is a way, this is just in my own head, nothing
sure.
Based on nothing,
all right.
But a way to kind of postpone that pressure of tell, you know, go to bed with me, or tell me what you want, or, you know, who are you, and all of that. And in those teen years, in those middle and teen years, as a way to kind of say, let me be. Let me figure it out on my own without telling you what to do. Have you seen any, do you have any comment on that?
Yeah, I would say that as someone who, when I was in elementary school, I knew the word gay as like a slur, right? Like, that's so gay. I didn't really know what it meant, and this was in the 80s, right? I had my mother's cousin is gay. I didn't really get it, right? I thought he had a friend. Because this is the way it was talked about, right? And so I knew when I heard my grandmother, who I love dearly, said something very negative about gay people. I remember that, even though I was really young, and I knew, like, that's about me. Like, I am connected to that. And I didn't know, going then into middle and high school, I didn't know there was such a thing as transgender, right? Because this was the 80s and then the 90s. Eventually in high school, I kind of figured out that in the back of, like, some of these magazines that you go into, I grew up in Rhode Island, so you go into Providence, you get this magazine to find out when all the music shows were, right, or the art. And in the back of that magazine, something was going on with people who looked like women, but then there was this whole sort of other thing, right? And these were transgender women who were doing sex work, basically. So I knew, like, that exists, but what I'm trying to get at is I didn't know there was even such a thing as being a transgender man. And so, this is kind of circular, but what I'm trying to get at is I think that this ability that kids have now, more than I think it's a burden on them, it's a freedom, because they are able to explore something that generations of other people felt, but were told, like, no way, right? So, I also think, like, we have to be careful, right? So I think for a long time we've said about bisexual people, oh, they just can't choose. And I think trans people, like myself, are sometimes now saying about people who are gender nonconforming, come on, like, yeah, I get being trans, but, like, be male or female. And I imagine that you're right? That some of these kids are working through something that they're gonna come out on one side or the other of. Absolutely. But some of them probably really are always going to feel that they're not one or the other. And for me, I think the important thing is making space in the world we live in for everyone. So we don't have to take away from Sophia Loren or John Wayne, we don't have to destroy those things. That's okay to be like, hey, this is my femininity and it's 100% this, or my masculinity, but leave space for that high school kid who was assigned male but likes dresses. Because at the end of the day, to me, if that person is happy with that, it's not really, you know. So I think, yes, maybe it's a place where people are exploring, but I think that's okay.
Yeah. I think, like, I don't know before, but here's my, I'm 65. Here's my generation right now, growing up with the beginning of Elvis Presley and Mick Jagger of the Rolling Stones, forget over the Beatles, we're looking at Michael Jackson, Prince, David Bowie, all of these people who are androgynous or have made, I don't know for sure, but seem like they've gone back between male and female genders, and they are publicly on display as role models for a lot of the kids in their music that they identify with. I don't ever know of my father, like from my father, before Elvis Presley, or and maybe it exists, but I have never heard about it, or even in the past seen it, you know, made okay. Like,
right.
I feel like all
right.
these popular things make it okay, or are trying to make, not
right.
intentionally, but.
Right. Yeah, I think you're right that gender expression, especially in popular culture, right, so some, especially in music, has become more diverse. So when we talk about expression, we're just talking about the way someone's presenting themselves, right? Their clothing, their hairstyle, etc. And you mentioned Prince or David Bowie, right? These are people who were definitely playing with gender. As someone who, so I was a history professor, actually. And as someone who has that background as a historian, I can certainly tell you there were always people, right? In various cultures, in different ways, there have always been people who presented both, who flipped back and forth with it. But was it magnified the way it is with someone like Prince? No, because the technology to magnify it wasn't there. So if you're talking prior to the advent of television, certainly there was a vibrant drag culture in a lot of American cities by the 1890s. Certainly 1920s, 1930s, there's a lot of evidence, right? There's, at that point, you have flyers, you have photographs, right? Of people who were doing drag or who saw themselves sometimes male, sometimes female. That wasn't going to be disseminated to the entire American public because you did not have that technology. So I think part of what goes along with that sexual revolution that's happening in the 60s is all of a sudden everyone's seeing this. And I think what we're seeing now is a parallel to that. All of a sudden, everybody knows that there are a bunch of ways to identify in terms of gender because of the internet, right? So that's, you're seeing, yeah. Actually, sorry, you had a question a while ago and then I...
Well, that was a comment. Similar thing with a three-year-old who says he's a boy, but he comes to school dressed as a girl.
Right.
I mean, older, I'm just... You know, but he says, I'm
so,
and he's three.
Right.
So, you know, we're saying, where did he get all those girls' clothes? And he has a brother.
Mm-hmm. So,
it just, yeah.
Yeah, so for me, I think I always, it's to me, it's about like, you don't have to classify a kid that age as transgender or not. Unless there's like, you know, really serious issues around depression and even, you know, talking in a way that would be seen by a psychiatrist as like suicidality, then maybe if the kid's pressing, you say, okay. But like basically the protocol is for the parents to say that if they're going to be accepting of it, right? If you want to take that avenue with it, for those parents to say, okay, if you want to wear these clothes, that's fine. If it were my kid, like I always feel like a good way to be about this is clothes are just clothes, toys are just toys, you want to play with these toys, or you know, very different than what we did in the 50s and even what we did 25 years ago, right? But you're not pushing the kid to identify one way or the other, because what you started out saying is he says I'm a boy. So this could very well be someone who's very clear that he's a boy. And he was assigned male at birth, he identifies as male, but he likes tutus and he likes Barbie. And maybe he'll continue to like tutus and Barbie, and maybe he won't. And right. So, yeah.
Could you talk a little more about your own personal experience in terms of how, you know, your journey and figuring out yourself?
Sure.
How, at what point, and how you felt about them, and how you made a decision to transgender?
So, like I said, when I was growing up, I wasn't aware that there was such a thing as being transgender. So I knew that I was considered a tomboy, right? That I was a girl who, I have like a whole thing where it's like, okay. So I was this kid in the 80s, right? I didn't like my name, so I had shortened it to a nickname that was male, like a version of that name that's shorter, but that's also male. I had to have that name on my sports, like if I played soccer, I played softball, I had to have that name on it.
And what was that name? I'm sorry. Like back then, what did you, what
well,
was the name you
so, trans people like really don't like to answer that. And I don't mind it too much, but I tend to like not do it because a lot of trans people feel like if I tell you that, that's how you'll think of me.
Yeah.
Right? So let's say my name was Alexandra because it wasn't.
Right.
Okay. Then I shortened it to Alex. That sort of a thing, right? And so I remember that a lot of times people would mistake me for male, right? Because of the way I looked and my name on my coat and like I was, all my friends were boys. And whenever they would mistake me for male, I would be like thrilled, right? Sometimes if you were out in public and this happened, my mother would correct them and that would be like really embarrassing. And I remember wishing like, oh, I wish I was a boy. But knowing like the reality is though, that's not reality, so that's not gonna happen. So as I went through puberty, I also started to realize that this was like totally acceptable. So my parents are like leftist hippies from the 60s. This was totally acceptable to them. You could be a tomboy, you could be a girl and be whatever, a boy and be whatever. But as you got older, there was an expectation that like that's something people grow out of. My mom, who's feminine to me, I think, would say, I was a tomboy. I was totally a tomboy. But now I would look at her and say, think, yeah, but you have like your nails painted and you don't look that. You look like you're very into femininity. And so it was kind of expected, I think, that that's something you grow out of. And I really didn't grow out of it. And so that made junior high kind of awkward. By the time I went to high school, presenting like male, it was kind of not getting me a lot of friends. So when I typically show these, I'm like doing this identity versus. So this is me when I went to the junior prom. And so you would probably say like, oh, female, very, very female, right? But you might also notice I had short hair. So this was a day that I basically said, okay, like my friend who I kind of like, but we're just friends because like I'm kind of like boyish. He doesn't have anyone to go with. I don't have anyone to go with. He asked me to go. I kind of want to go with him. My mom was super happy because she was like, oh my God, like let's go. We're Italian, so she was like, let's get our nails done. And we got these fake, that was the only time I ever had fake nails, and that's a nightmare. But you can't like pick anything up, you can't type, and then like they rip off. But anyway, so I went to the prom. But then I basically reverted to the way I looked most of the time. And I actually remember being in the dressing room and having like my regular clothes and then trying that on. And a woman, an older woman came up and was like, that was you. And she was trying to be so nice, like encouraging, like, wow, like you're beautiful and you should dress like that. You look great. And I was like, oh God, this is horrible. but anyway, so I don't want to leave that stat sitting there. So I think by the time I was in high school, I started to have issues around it because I started to realize I was attracted to men. So like, what did that mean? Other people started to basically say, that kid's a lesbian. Like, aren't you a lesbian? Like, why won't you admit that you're a lesbian, right? because we see you as masculine, so you must be a lesbian. And I also, so then I went to college, and in college, I took a couple of women's studies courses, and that made me feel like what my mother was kind of saying, which was, this is anti-feminist. Like, why would you not identify as a woman? Because that's rejecting something that she felt like she fought for, right? Women's rights. And I very much am a feminist. So that was also, but eventually, it came, I moved away. I went to University of Rhode Island, because I grew up in Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. And then I moved to DC for graduate school. And I was in grad school, and I just started to know more people who were transgender. And it, and I was very stressed out about it for a long time, because I thought, if you tell people this, like, who knows what's going to happen, right? My parents going to be rejecting of it. I was very stressed out about it. And I feel like it just finally in my mind came down. I was in my mid-20s, and it came down to, you have one life, and this is what's going to make you happy. So who cares what these other people think? And so I told my parents, and my dad was actually really accepting right away. I think he basically said, there's a lot that people, it's a different time now, and people are more accepting of this, so that's a good thing. And we never really talked about it again. I mean, I transitioned. He pretty much segued pretty seamlessly into going with my new name and pronouns. My mother had a really hard time with it. So she, I think, primarily was coming from a place where she was, I think two things, like she was upset because like she identifies as female and like, why would I reject that? And what did that mean for our relationship? But also from a place where she felt like, well, people are discriminated against because of this and I don't want you to be discriminated. So it took, I would say, like 5 years before my mom, like I felt like she sees me as male now, because she always uses male pronouns, always uses the correct name. And that took a while. But I was very, very lucky in those things. I know a lot of trans people who whose parents were rejecting. And for the most part, were rejecting because of either their political or their religious beliefs. And that's been very tough for those people, right? And I think it's tough for the parents too. Like I'm not saying I support rejecting your kid, but I understand that these are people who feel like this is what I believe. It's very deep. It's very personal. This is my religion, and so I feel like I was really lucky in it. And I would also say I was lucky in it. One of the things, like I think, like just to maybe even just close up. I said something about this is a very individual experience, right? And so when we look at the shockingly high statistics for suicide in the trans community, or violence in the trans community, or the discrimination that transgender people face, that primarily affects transgender women, and in particular transgender women of color, because it primarily affects people who don't have the ability to pass, right? So by pass, what I mean is, if I leave here and I go to Starbucks, they're gonna say, what do you want in your coffee, sir? And I'm gonna say whatever I'm gonna say, but I'm not gonna say, oh, by the way, I'm transgender, right? So like, people don't know. But if you were assigned male at birth and you went through a male puberty and you're 6'4", right? And you had a full beard and you're struggling through changing all of that to pass as female, you're gonna have a tougher time. And one of the things we're working on in New Jersey is a lot of this stuff is just starting to be covered by insurance, right? So I pay for my insurance. I want it to cover what I need it to cover, just like anyone else. So when we say it falls out disproportionately on transgender women of color, that's because of how entwined race and class are in this country. It's because of racism itself, right? That other systems have put this particular person in a situation where they're more likely to face that violence. And so, again, it's like this very individual experience. So I don't know if we have any more time, but I'm happy to take questions.
Yeah.
I'm very concerned with this administration. They've taken down the website for civil rights at the White House. They've taken it off the Justice Department. And I am very fearful. And there's a lot of people in the government that are anti-LGBT.
Yes.
I am very concerned about this. What can we do?
Yes. Okay. So this is certainly something that a lot of LGBT people and a lot of people in various minority groups and a lot of people right are very concerned about. I would say get involved with whatever organization is the particular issue you feel is most compelling to you. One of the things we're trying to do in New Jersey, we know that we stand to potentially lose federal protection around LGBT issues in schools, LGBT issues in healthcare, and even the possible passage of like a First Amendment Defense Act. And so we're trying to build like a firewall against that with New Jersey state law, right? And so New Jersey is kind of, they're like at the bottom of the good state. The way that they rate these maps, I showed you like one of the maps, but if you look at this map, this is just the non-discrimination laws, and New Jersey's good there. Well, 22 states have sued the federal government, saying that they won't allow transgender students to, use the restroom they identify with, and not just that, but like the whole guidance. Another 11 states on the other side have done this at the State Department of Education level, meaning whatever happens with the federal, the state is protected. New Jersey's in between, right? We don't have anything at the state level. We're working on that. With healthcare, the Affordable Care Act actually, so I have like a little, where is it? Oh, yeah. The Affordable Care Act, whatever you may think about it, actually is the first place where the non-discrimination clause in healthcare protects LGBT people, protects people on the basis of gender identity and expression and sexual orientation. And so if the Affordable Care Act gets dismantled and that's gone, I mean, we are in a situation in New Jersey where a lot of people have been denied health insurance coverage for transition-related care. But it isn't just that, right? You can be denied treatment. And that's real, right? So that actually happens. And it happens anywhere from, okay, I was denied in this hospital, it was a humiliating experience, it didn't endanger my health because I was able to go somewhere else, to places around this country where there's nowhere else to go, to situations like when I was living in DC, there was a transgender woman who was in a car accident, looked very female. After they got her out of the car and had to cut open her dress, they saw that she had been assigned male, right? She had male genitalia. And the paramedics like laughed at her. And nobody took care of this woman and she died. And so that sort of thing happens, right? And so LGBT people are really concerned about it. I would say, though, certainly you can, I have my card here and everything. We can talk about what we're doing at Garden State Equality. And, you know, we're kind of working on this issue, on these issues, right? And there's other issues as well.
Yeah.
So my card and some information about the work we do is in the back, so if you want to reach out, feel free.